people are suffering from a loss of meaning. And so video games are one of the things that people look for is they look for that sense of presence. We have lost touch with our wisdom traditions.
你好。Hi everyone, I'm Celine. Welcome back to my channel. If you want to study spirituality and live more consciously, one topic or one area of study we have to talk about is cognitive science. So what is cognitive science? It is basically an interdisciplinary scientific approach to study how our mind works. Recently, I had the pleasure meeting with the cognitive science professor at the University of Toronto. His name is John Vervaeke. He's an award-winning lecturer and got many likes from his students. He also has his own YouTube channel, which he posts a lot of stuff relates to wisdom study and spirituality and how ourselves as individual can awake from this meaning crisis. This series will be divided into three parts. And today I will share the first part with you guys. I hope you guys enjoy this video.
Thank you so much for joining me on this conversation.
My pleasure.
So the first question I have here is, I'm sure you got asked a lot in different occasions. So could you please define what's meaning crisis?
Sure. Okay, so let's talk about first how I'm using the word meaning. Mm-hmm. And when we use the word meaning, we're actually using a metaphor because sentences have meaning. And what we're saying, you know, and why does a sentence have meaning? Because the words fit together, they're organized together so that they fit me, and then they help me fit the world. That's what it is when I understand the meaning of a sentence. Mm-hmm. So what we're saying is, to say that there's meaning in our life is to say that our lives fit together in such a way that the world fits us and we fit the world, that we're connected. Now that connectedness is bound up with the way in which our intelligence makes us adaptive. To say that you're connected to the world means you're fit to the world, the way an organism is actually fitted to the world in a biological sense. And the idea is the processes that make us intelligently adaptive, that are constantly evolving our cognitive fittedness to the world, are also processes that make us inevitably, unavoidably susceptible to self-deception. So the very processes that make us adaptive make us prone to self-deception. And then those self-deception patterns undermines that connectivity. When we deceive ourselves, we're becoming disconnected from ourselves, and we're becoming disconnected from the world, and our behavior often becomes self-destructive and destructive of other people, so we become disconnected from other people. And so what cultures have done across environmental and historical contexts is they've come up with what I call ecologies of practices, which is a living system of practices that has checks and balances, mutual constraint and mutual affordance for addressing these very complex patterns of self-deceptive, self-destructive behavior, ameliorating them, and affording a reconnection and a deepening of those lost connections that we lose through self-deception, self-destructive behavior. And so I think, and there's many of my fellow researchers think, the word that best describes that capacity for comprehensively reducing self-deception and affording enhanced meaning is wisdom. And wisdom therefore differs in important ways from knowledge. And so what's been happening in the West, whatever that points to now, it's not clear anymore because of globalization and all kinds of things. But what's been happening, at least in European history and then European North American history for a very long time, is we have lost touch with our wisdom traditions. We have pursued strategies of obtaining more and more information, more and more knowledge, although now we're obtaining information, and T.S. Eliot forewarned about this, we're obtaining information at the expense of being able to get knowledge. And then behind that, we're often obtaining knowledge at the expense of cultivating wisdom and virtue. And so what happens is we lost a worldview, and these worldviews have traditionally been given to us by religions. We lost a worldview that validated and honed and legitimated and drew people to these wisdom ecologies. And so the wisdom ecologies became orphaned, fragmented, forgotten, twisted. And so people can't stop trying to deal with self-deception, and they can't stop pursuing meaning in life, because if they stop, they'll probably fall into mental illness or suicide. And so people still have to try and cultivate wisdom, but they don't know where to go. They don't know who to look to. They don't know what models, and they don't know how any of that fits in the scientific worldview that is the prominent worldview in the world right now. And so because of that, people are suffering tremendously. And you can see this in many symptoms expressed throughout the culture of how people are suffering from a loss of meaning, a sense that they're being overwhelmed by foolish behavior within and without, that we're losing the ability to discern in information knowledge and to discern in knowledge wisdom. We're being overwhelmed by bullshit, to use a Frankfurt's term. So all of this is what I mean by the meaning crisis.
Mm-hmm. Wow. There are several questions just came to my mind when you're talking about loss in meaning and this kind of a self-deceptive behavior. Could you give us more a real life example of like how people deceive themselves?
Sure. So the thing we have to give up is the metaphor that you lie to yourself, and that self-deception is about lying to yourself. That's not, you can't really lie to yourself. That doesn't make any sense. What we have to do is we have to make a distinction. I invoked it a few minutes ago between lying and bullshitting. So when I lie to you, I depend on the truth being a huge motivational factor for you. If I can get you to believe something that's true, so believe something is true when it's actually not true, you'll be motivated by the sense of its truth. That'll motivate you. So that's what lying is. Bullshitting is very different. Bullshitting is I get you to find things salient and get you to not care about whether or not they're true. They're just catchy and they're salient, and I make it so that you stop asking questions, you stop reflecting. That's what the bullshit artist does, right? So the bullshit artist isn't concerned with whether or not what they're saying is true. They're concerned with whether or not they can manipulate you by getting you to not care about whether or not it's true anymore. There's a big difference there, right? Now, you can't lie to yourself because what would you hey, John, believe this, which you don't believe. And also, beliefs aren't things you directly control. They're not actions. Like, pick a belief you'd like to have. Well, I'd like to believe that everybody loves me. Well, here, I'll just do it now. I'll just start believing it. Well, they can't. I can imagine it. I can wish for it, but I can't believe it. So instead of thinking of self-deception as lying to yourself, that common metaphor, put that aside and think of self-deception as bullshitting yourself. So how would you bullshit yourself? Well, the thing about that is bullshitting has to do with making things salient. And the interesting thing about your attention is it can make things salient. So if I say to you right now, your left big toe, now you're aware of it. It stands out in your awareness. But your attention is also grasped by things that are salient. So you can attend to things, make them more salient so that they're likely to get your attention, so that you will pay more attention to them, and then you get this loop, right? And that's what advertising does. Advertising is, oh yeah, here's somebody drinking alcohol, and then there's all these beautiful people around them. And so we find that salient. We don't believe it's true. You go into a bar, that's not what it's like. But nevertheless, it's salient. The alcohol is salient. So we're more likely to pay attention when we're in the store to that alcohol. And because we pay more attention to the alcohol in the store, that brand of alcohol, we think we like it and we're more likely to buy it. And then we are. There we go. And we do that to ourselves. Now, we do it to ourselves because, again, of adaptive machinery. So let me give you a very clear example, one I use because people find it very accessible. If you were, so your attention is adaptive, this will sound really bizarre at first, by not paying attention to most of the information that's available to you. The amount of information in the environment, in your memory, and right, it's just overwhelming. So what your attention actually does is get you to only find, a very small subset of that salient. That's adaptive. Okay, so let me give you an example. it's very helpful to us to know the probability of events. We're always trying to, it's adapted to be able to anticipate an event, right? But if I were to actually try to calculate using probability math, the probability of real world events, it's overwhelming. It's called combinatorial explosion. I couldn't do it. It would take me the rest of the history of the universe to do the calculation. So human brains don't do that. We don't do that. What do we do in order to judge the probability of things? Well, we use a couple of things that bias our attention. So if I can easily imagine or remember an event, I'll consider that type of event very probable. And if that event is really sort of, if it really stands out, if it's a very prototypical, you know, example of its category, then I'll think it's very probable. And so this is what we used to do in the pre-COVID days, in those ancient days in which people would go to airports, right? Because what we do is we take a loved one to the airport, and as they're about to leave, we basically say all these euphemisms to them for don't die. We're saying, you know, have a safe trip, text me when you're there, as if somehow that's going to protect them, right? We're doing all, because we're anxious that we're going to lose them, right? Why? Well, think about it. How easy is it for you to imagine an airplane crashing? It's really easy. It's a big metal thing falling from the sky. And what happens when an airplane crashes? Do they call it an accident or a crash? No, they say it's a tragedy or a disaster. So both of those things make you think, oh, airplane crash is very probable, highly likely. And actually, it's extremely unlikely. And then what you do without thinking about it is you leave the airport and get into an automobile, which is the North American death machine, that is like the number one killer for various age groups in North America. You have just been subject to self-deception. You are worried about the airplane crash, and you don't care at all about the possibility of the car crash. That's self-deception. So the very process that's making you adaptive is also misleading you and making you miscalculate, for example, the probability of events. And that has a direct impact on your potential safety. That could end up being a self-destructive form of self-deception. Did that help?
Yes, yes, that's pretty clear. I was like imagining, because I flew back to China once a year, and I was like, oh my gosh, yes, that's so real, but at the same time, so self-deceptive.
Yep.
It's kind of like we're using this as a tool to survive. At the same time, it's hinder our ability to yep. survive better.
Yeah, yeah, that's right. Oh.
Mm-hmm. So
now go ahead. The thing is, that's not a council of despair, because mm-hmm. we have the science that can teach us about this, and then we have the fact that we are reflective beings. We can take, we have what's called an ability that's considered central to wisdom, is a meta perspectival ability. We can become aware of how we're paying attention. We can pay attention to how we're paying attention. We can pay attention to how we're finding things salient. And using the science and the knowledge, we can intervene to counteract. So when you're in that situation, you go, wait. Be confident about the airplane. Be cautious about the car. Right?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. It's kind of like the metacognition.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that actually leads to my second question about the solution for dealing with this meaning crisis. So you mentioned a little bit about how we as individual can develop this kind of a metacognition or analyzing information in a more conscious way.
Yep.
So, yeah. Could you please speak more about how individual and also maybe groups or organization can what roles they can play?
The thing about that is that, again, means you have to really unpack more the best science of cognition, cognitive science, cognitive psychology, right? And so we have to think of the fact that we gain knowledge in different kinds of ways. And so the kind of knowledge we're really familiar with is, because we're talking about it all day long, it's propositional knowledge. It's the kind of knowledge that you get from stating propositions. It has to do with your beliefs. Your belief that something is the case. I believe that cats are mammals. So your belief, and there's a proposition as content. But that's very different from procedural knowledge or procedural knowing. Procedural knowing is knowing how to do something, knowing how to catch a baseball, knowing how to ride a bike, knowing how to swim, knowing how to walk, right? Now, that's not really a belief. It's a skill. And it's not something that you consider true or false, right? Instead, it's whether or not the skill is powerful or not, whether it's happening smoothly or clumsily, right? And so we have these different senses of realness. We sense reality when we sense our beliefs are true, but we sense reality when we find our skills powerful. But then we just talked about something else a minute ago. You have perspectival knowing. You know what it's like to have a perspective. What does that mean? What are you finding salient right here, right now, in your current state of mind? What is standing out for you? What's in the background? What is it like to be in your state of mind right here, right now? That's your perspectival knowing. And what that gives you, and we know what it gives you because we've discovered this through work in virtual reality, is it gives you a sense of what's called a sense of presence, a sense of really being here now. And so video games are one of the things that what people look for is they look for that sense of presence. They want to feel like they're really in the game here now, that sense of presence. Because what is that? Well, that's your situational awareness. That's your awareness of how you're sizing up the current situation. And that situational awareness tells you which skills you should apply or which skills you should acquire. So that perspectival knowing is really, really important too. It has a lot to do with your consciousness. And then of course, below this is which the kind of knowing that has to do with your character is your participatory knowing. This is the way in which you know by being the kind of being you are, having the kind of body you have, having the kind of mind you have. It's the way in which biology and culture and your current state of mind shape you and the environment together. And that generates what are called affordances. So for example, this remote is graspable to me. It's been shaped, right? My hand evolved to grasp objects in the environment, right? But this has also been shaped by culture to fit me, right? And so it's graspable. And so the kind of body I have, the kind of mind I have, right? The kind of character I'm cultivating, open up affordances for me. What's walkable, graspable, thinkable, doable. And then my perspectival knowing makes all of those, there's way too many affordances. It makes some of those affordances. So right now, you know, a minute ago, the graspability of this was irrelevant to me. But now my perspectival knowing, wait, that's graspable. And I pick it up, right? And then I can start applying my skills to it. Oh, I can turn my TV on and off. Right? And then I can form beliefs about the world. Hey, this is a remote. Do you see all these things, right? And notice that I only really deeply understand what this is when I have all of those four kinds of knowings really well aligned and in sync with each other. Is that okay so far?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So now think about this, right? Each one of these kinds of knowings have different ways in which you can fall into self-deception. There's also ways in which you can fall in self-deception by the stack getting out of alignment. So there's complex ways in which you can fall into self-deception. And all of these things can actually mutually reinforce each other. So you have to really cultivate an ecology of practices. You have to come up with practices that will intervene on this kind of self-deception, right? But need to be counterbalanced with ones that will intervene on this kind of self-deception. Let me give an example. Okay, so one of the things that I need in perspectival is often, right, I misframe things. I'm finding the wrong things salient, like when I'm bullshitting myself or when I'm trying to solve a problem and it's like, what? I can't figure this out. And then you have a ha moment. Oh, wait, I should have been paying attention to this or this. Have you had one of those experiences? Okay,
it's
that's
like
insight.
It's a blind spot. Kind of
Yeah. And then you realize it, right? And you go, oh, wow. Okay, so what's happening there is your mind has this ability to leap outside of its perspective, right? And to restructure its perspective. It's called cognitive leaping. So you need insight to overcome self-deception. So what you can do is you can cultivate meta-perspectival abilities, paying attention to attention, that will enhance insight. That's mindfulness practices. But here's the problem. If I always jump like that, and I'm over here and I'm making an argument and I'm trying to go step by step to change my beliefs. And if I jump to the conclusion, then that's a disaster. Most fallacious reasoning comes from jumping to a conclusion, using your intuition. So notice what happens. In one context, the insight machinery makes you very adaptive, but in another context, it makes you very maladaptive. Oh, well, then I should just always think my way through things. No, no, no. If you are always doing that step-by-step thing, you'll stay inside your frame and you won't have insight. So what do you need to do? We need mindfulness to shut off all that inference to improve insight, but you need another practice called active open-mindedness that helps you pay attention to the ways in which you're leaping to conclusions when you're making inferences. And active open-mindedness dims down the insight machinery to protect inference, and mindfulness dims down the inference machinery to protect insight, and the two act like a check and balance on each other, and you're constantly toggling between them in a dynamic fashion. What I need is a whole bunch of those in a really complex ecology of practices in order to cultivate wisdom. And that's what religions did. Religions are these complex ecologies of practices for overcoming individual and collective, I haven't talked about that yet, but individual and collective self-deception and enhancing individual and collective meaning in life. Now, I'm not advocating for religion, I'm not. But what I'm saying is the reason why religions are so pervasive and universal, they do many things. I'm not claiming this is exclusive, but one of the most powerful things that religions did where they were homes, they created worldviews and social structures and historical traditions for generating, curating, cultivating, correcting ecologies of practices. We've lost religious frameworks and we've lost that, how to cultivate these ecologies of practices. And if you try and do it on your own, the chances you're gonna succeed on your own, you're gonna get this autodidactic, fragmented thing that's just as likely to exacerbate that self-deception pattern rather than improving it.
I was becoming a little bit hopeful when you're talking about, oh, we can actually do this and that. I was like, okay, self-help really work. But again, like you mentioned something also about it become, how it will lead to disaster if we're just doing this on our own.
Well, so when you're just doing it on your own, so first of all, how do you get that meta perspectival ability we were talking about a few minutes ago? Because little kids don't have it initially. How do they acquire it? Well, this is how they acquire it. At least this is our best account. It comes from Vygotsky and other people. So let's say I'm teaching my son when he's little. And what does he do? He imitates me. Mm-hmm. He imitates me. And so my perspective encompasses his perspective because I have a bigger perspective. And he imitates me taking a bigger perspective on him. And he keeps imitating it and imitating it until eventually he can do that without me being around. And he can take that bigger perspective on himself without me being around. And that's how you get that metacognitive ability, that meta-perspectival ability. You acquire it through other people. Now, you can improve it and enhance it on your own. But if you're trying to set out on a new path to cultivate a lot of meta-perspectival ability, first of all, you don't have a knowledge of all of these biases and how they work. And you don't have a bunch of people that will afford you that meta-perspectival self-transcendence. You might get lucky. But you're going to read a book. Well, that's a lot of propositions. Is that going to give you the procedural knowledge? Is it going to give you the perspectival knowledge? Is it going to give you the participatory knowledge? No. If you would say, I'm going to get really good at golf just by reading a book about golf and thinking about it a lot, imagining it. You're going to get good at golf? No. So you really need other people. And the problem with the way we think about other people right now because of social media is we don't serve a community. We often create a bubble of people that reinforce our bias, reinforce our confirmation bias. And so we are not really getting anything meta-perspectival. We're not really challenging our biases. And so chances are we're going to, without realizing it, fall prey to more self-deception. And failures at a participatory and perspectival level, it can really feed narcissism, can really right? You can get very, that self-deception can be bound up with a kind of self-absorption that's particularly pernicious.
Mm. So what I'm hearing is that we kind of, not only within ourselves, we need to develop and cultivate as much as we can. And we also need a community of people yeah. that can offer us different, not like the same biases, but different kind of discussion right. or perspective.
Exactly. So you need individual ecologies of practices set within group ecologies of practices. You have to have a nesting of ecologies of practices. And so I'm doing a lot of work right now, especially with Christopher Mastropietro and people like Guy Sendstock and Jordan Hall and Peter Lindbergh and others, the people at Rebel Wisdom, and trying to figure out what are the practices that we can do collectively. Just like I've been talking about how we can use individual intelligence to cultivate individual wisdom, can we use the collective intelligence of right, distributed cognition, right, to bootstrap that up into collective wisdom so that we can give people a community in which their individual cultivation of wisdom has a significant chance of succeeding? We already have empirical evidence. My student in RA, Jun-Sun Kim, has done evidence that people who are in established religions, or at least established traditions, maybe that's a better way of putting it, although the two are often interwoven, are much better at cultivating wisdom than people who are not.
I don't know. I have a question, because I think you mentioned about how groups can reinform our biases.
Yep, they can.
But how, like, okay, maybe I'm understanding wrong about religion or organized organization. I thought they have this kind of a more fixed view. Mm.
So that's this really interesting thing. It was my great pleasure to meet, and I got to talk to him recently. Unfortunately, he just passed away, James Carse. He wrote a book, a really important book called The Religious Case Against Belief. And notice the title, The Religious Case Against Belief. We have tended to reduce, we even use these terms synonymous now, like religion, faith, and belief, as if they're all synonymous. We've reduced this process of meaning making that's largely taking place at the level of our skills, our states of mind, our traits of character, and not primarily at the level of our beliefs, but we've tried to reduce all of that meaning making to affirming the truths of particular propositions. And we sort of mistaken the metaphor for what it's a metaphor of. And so religions have tended, and we've tended to think about this in modernity, they've tended to generate it, and you did this with your hand, like you're limiting your perspective. We have these beliefs that we have to adhere to. And James's critique, the religious case against the belief, about belief is, religion, to use my terms, but I've talked to him, so he's happy with my terms, right? No, religion is always about constantly evolving your capacity to overcome self-deception and to enhance your connectedness to the world. Just like organisms are constantly evolving through time, what religion should be constantly doing is re-evolving our capacity for wisdom. And then I'll quote Socrates here, right? Wisdom begins in wonder, not curiosity. Curiosity is when you're trying to get knowledge that will fill in a hole. Wonder is your capacity to step back and call yourself and your world into question, because that's ultimately what you really need if you're going to challenge comprehensive self-deceptive behavior. So religions should be about giving people ecologies of practices, a worldview that is not bullshit, that's not contra science, that doesn't contradict science or knowledge, because we need to constantly use the evolving knowledge to provoke wonder about how we should evolve our capacity, wonder and awe, but how we should evolve our capacity for cultivating wisdom. And that's what I think when religions are working, or at least when under ideal conditions, perhaps, I don't know. But that's the, well, let me put it this way. Instead of trying to pick a historical period, I think that's the part of religion that's always working. And religion is doing a good job when that's prominent. But there's lots of parts of religions that nowadays aren't working. And often what's making them not work is the meaning-making wisdom cultivation is precisely not central to the religious practice.
So I hope you guys enjoyed this video. And next week, we will be sharing the second part of our interview, which we talked about how individuals can borrow the tools from mindfulness and collective wisdom to be truly transformed from the meaning crisis. If you want to learn more about personal development and spirituality, please subscribe to my YouTube channel. And if you have any questions or concerns or any topics you want me to dive into, or the speakers you want to see on my show, please comment below. I will see you guys in the next video. Bye bye.
I wanna see what different